down here because they're putting cameras up. They're installing surveillance cameras. Not that we need them on this corner. You never know. But anyway, so I didn't know when the interruption in there was, so I thought we could come down here and have our Bible study down here. So you're actually going to have to, if you don't have a Bible, you have to go upstairs and get one. Because we don't have the screen down here. Or you can just take my word.
Yeah, what a bummer.
Anyway, it's good to be in the Lord's house. Okay? Yeah. Why don't we thank the Lord? Say hello to everybody at Facebook. Hello, Facebook. I hope you can hear me all right.
We'll see you.
And, if you see me,
you
can hear me. I don't want to see me. Anyhow. Well, why don't we stand if you want to? If you don't want to, you can stay seated too.
That's good.
And we're going to worship the Lord a little bit. All right. Yeah. So I'll try to sing songs everybody knows.
Good.
Alive, alive.
Thank you.
upstairs or downstairs, or wherever we might be, we know the Spirit of the Lord is in the midst of us. Father, we just pray, Lord, that you would reach down and touch each and every person in this room with healing, with deliverance, Lord, with peace, with hope. Father, sometimes things look hopeless, but it's never hopeless. Dance with this, you have to watch out because you might hit each other. I want to shout.
Jesus loves me, this I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones may be wrong. We are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, He does. Change one word. I want you to point at somebody real nice and say, Jesus loves you, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones stay in, the big ones do. We are weak, but He is strong.
Upstairs, or we got some cameras, some surveillance cameras, which is kind of long overdue. So anyway, they're installing them, so I didn't want to interrupt them in the middle of their work, so we figured we'd come down here. We got goodies. The only reason we're down here is because somebody wants some cake here tonight. So if anybody wants to go get some goodies, there's some coffee, and there's water in the fridge. You can help yourself. I will not be offended if you get up while I'm speaking. I'll just give you a dirty look, that's all. No, I won't even do that. That's okay. So we're kind of cool tonight. A couple announcements. And again, I say hello to everybody on Facebook and wondering why we're down in the cellar. That's the reason why. But just a couple announcements. Sister Stacy, her mom passed away. Stacy Thompson. It was in the paper today. The viewing is from, Stacy.
Yeah.
Yeah, her mom passed away. The funeral is going to be at Duster's in Trenum. Viewing is 2 to 7 and 4.
2 to
4 and 7 to 9. Thank you. I had the right number, just the wrong word. 2 to 4 and 7 to 9 tomorrow. And then the funeral will be 11 o'clock on Friday morning. So keep Stacy and Joycey and Carla. And I can't remember the other sister's name. Keep them in your prayers. They're having it well. She was ill for a while, Jenny. So keep them in your prayers. Sister Judy's back home. Judy Rabb is back home. I think Elaine is back home. Elaine's back home. Please keep Mike O'Connor, Debbie's husband, in your prayers because he's awaiting a lung transplant. So who else?
Pray that Darlene can hold her head up.
Yes, Sister Darlene Wahlberg had surgery. She had detached retina. That was last Thursday. So they said for a week she had to walk around with her head down like this. So, hopefully it should be that tomorrow's a week, so hopefully she should be okay. They don't know if it was from that car accident. They're not sure. But anyway, that's the only ones I can think of. Anything else I got to think about? Any other kind of people? Yes?
I wanted to give a praise report. Yes. The lady that I walk with in our neighborhood, we prayed for her husband, Dwayne. Mm-hmm. He went in the hospital with cancer and stuff. And she said, make sure you tell your church thank you because he's a miracle when he came out. I was talking to them today.
Yeah, it reminds me, I'd be praying for Pastor Harold.
Yes.
Pastor Harold Malik, he's still up at Allegheny Valley Hospital. They found a little blood clot in his leg. So now they're trying to kind of adjust the blood thinner stuff, but his fever's gone, and Harold, how he is, he's telling everybody about Jesus. So it's a missions trip. He says every place he goes is a missions trip.
And that's what Harold did. It
is. So, okay. I think that's it. I know there's probably a few more. It's good to have all
outreach with us.
Friday. Yes, it's Friday. We'll be having a little outreach. Thank you. Right out here. And that'll be 7 o'clock or thereabouts, 6:30, 7 o'clock. So come on out if you want to witness a little bit. We like to get together with the neighbors, come by, and hopefully some kids will come by and be able to pray with them, minister to them, so That will be this Friday evening. Pray for good weather. Hopefully it won't rain. So, okay. Also, Brother George, our guitar player, he's still healing from his wrists and tendons. He kind of got messed up in his wrist, so pray for him to get back. He's still on injured reserve. You want to get back in the playing squad. Okay. All right. Well, praise the Lord. Okay. I feel kind of weird without like a
microphone.
But that's all right. Okay. Tonight, you know, the last several weeks on our Wednesday evenings, we've been talking about things, biblical things that we see manifesting today in our current events. I don't like to just talk about current events, but I like to talk about how they show us the validity of the scriptures. You remember last week we talked about how mankind is trying to build a technological tower of Babel with a CERN collider over there in Switzerland. They're trying to break through the fabric of space-time and all these crazy things that one time was science fiction. They're trying to make a wormhole to go to like another universe. They don't realize they're doing just what Satan tried to do when he tried to usurp God's authority. So really, man hasn't changed much. And tonight, I wanted to talk a little bit about the hottest piece of property on the planet right now, on the face of the earth. And of course, where is that? It's not in Kensington. It's Jerusalem, right? And especially the Temple Mount, the place where the Islamic religion has their mosque, and where the Jews have, there's a remnant of a temple, and where we believe someday they will build another temple, which would be really interesting how that's going to come about. The scriptures really discuss that. And I wanted, that piece of property is a very unique piece of property, and I wanted to talk about that a little bit tonight. And again, I'm doing this so you all will kind of grab a hold of the truth of what's going on in the world today. Evil, Satan is busier than he's ever been. He's always been pretty busy. And the things he's doing today is no different than the stuff he was doing 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 4,000 years ago. He's doing the same thing. He's trying to usurp God's authority in every way, in government, in economics, politics, in every way. And it's no different. Just recently, UNESCO, the United Nations Educational Society, whatever, they determined that the Jews have nothing to do with the Temple Mount. They said, you'll have no claim to it, right? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to read a little bit tonight, and I don't know if anybody has their Bible or something. We can't put up on the screen. So you'll have to take my word for it. If you want to sneak upstairs and get a Bible and follow, you can do that, or you can just listen to what I have to say, okay? That Temple Mount place, is very unique. Some of the Jewish rabbis and the teachers believe that that's where Cain and Abel were offering their sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Now, that's not a biblical truth, but the old Jewish teachers would teach that. One of the first times we hear about that place named is in Genesis chapter 22. How many people know what happened there? Genesis chapter 22. Oh boy, I better get back to teaching. Oh no, that's where, when God told Abraham, God said, Abraham, I want you to take your son, Isaac, and offer him to me as a burnt offering. So, Abraham took his son, Isaac, his only begotten son. He had a son before that. His name was Ishmael, but Ishmael was not the son of promise. He had to make Ishmael and his mother leave. But Isaac was the son of promise. Isaac was the son through whom the Messiah would come, the promised deliverer would come. So, he took Isaac, and we know the story. We're not going to go ahead and read it, because I think we all know the story. But Abraham took Isaac, and he had a donkey there, and he had wood on it, and he had fire, and they're going up to the top of the hill to make a sacrifice. And Isaac said, where's the sacrifice? Where's the lamb? And Abraham said, God will provide for himself a sacrifice. Now, if you read the book of Hebrews, you find out that Abraham, he had great faith when he was taking Isaac up there, because he believed that God would raise him from the dead. Okay? So he took Isaac up to the top of that hill, a place called Mount Moriah. Mount Moriah. Okay? That name is named elsewhere in the Old Testament. Mount Moriah. He took him up there, and he made the altar, and he put Isaac on the altar, And he got ready to slay him as a sacrifice, to kill him and then burn. And God stopped him. He said, Abraham, I know now that you're faithful. So God provided a ram who was caught in the bushes, and that became the sacrifice. And that was a place, when we read about it, it's a place where God provided a substitute for the only begotten son. Abraham was willing to offer his only begotten son, and God provided a substitute. Okay? The next place that it kind of comes into play here is over in 2 Samuel, and I'm going to read this a little bit. 2 Samuel chapter 24, and it's in here. And the story is this. Here's what was going on. David, King David, was approaching the end of his life. He was a great king, but he had a lot of problems in his life. He had a son that rebelled against him. He had another son that raped a daughter, and another son that killed a son. And so he had, and he committed adultery with Bathsheba. You all know that story. But here, David's coming to the end of his life, and he's getting ready to die. And what he did was he told his generals, and it was actually, the Bible says that God allowed Satan to tempt David, because God was angry with Israel for some reason. And that's a whole different, so we're not going to go into that whole story. But what happened was David told his generals, go and number all the people in Israel. Take a census. And his chief general, a guy named Joab, said, why do you want to do that? But he did it. And when he did it, God became angry with him, because some people say because David was proud, or because he didn't do it according to the law, or whatever. There's a whole teaching about that. But the bottom line is this. David realized that he had done wrong. And starting with verse 10 of 2 Samuel chapter 24. So we understand what happened, right? David's heart smote him after that he had numbered the people. And David said unto the Lord, I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Lord, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly. David repented. He repented for what he had done. Well, he had already done it. But he repented. But listen to what God said. For when David was up in the morning, the word of the Lord came unto the prophet Gad, David's seer, saying, go and say unto David, thus says the Lord, I offer thee three things. Choose thee one of them, that I may do it to thee. So the Lord said, okay, David, you repented. Well, I'm going to give you the choice of what you want me to do. Because God obviously felt the need to make an example of what he had done to show the people of his displeasure. So Gad came to David and said, shall 7 years of famine come into your land? Or will you flee 3 months before your enemies while they pursue you? Or that there be 3 days pestilence in the land? Now advise and see what answer I will return to the Lord. And David said unto Gad, listen, I don't care what God can do, what he wants to do. Just don't let me fall into the hands of man. I don't want to fall into the hands of man. So God sent pestilence. It says that in verse 15, so the Lord set a pestilence upon Israel. Now listen, all the people of Israel, they're suffering because of what David did. You know, sometimes we think, well, we can sin and we can do what we want to and nobody else suffers. But I guarantee you that there's always somebody else that's going to suffer. Well, Israel, all of Israel was suffering, right? Because of David's. And that tore David's heart up because, well, let's read. He says, the Lord set a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even to the time appointed. And there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men. And when the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord repented him of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed the people, that's enough. Stay your hand. And the angel of the Lord was by the threshing place of Arunah the Jebusite. Now, if you read the same account in 1 Chronicles, he's called Onan, Ornan, but it's the same name. It's just spelled differently. He says, so the angel came to this place, this threshing floor. How many people know what a threshing floor is? Threshing floor. In those days, they would take, when they would harvest wheat, they would have to separate the wheat from the chaff. And how they would do it, they would like beat it, okay, to get the wheat out, and then the stuff, the chaff, they would just like throw it away and burn it. But the wheat would be the good, the stuff you would want to keep. So the threshing floor was a place of like cleansing. And it says, David spoke unto the Lord when he saw the angel that smote the people and said, lo, I have sinned and have done wickedly, but these sheep, what have they done? Let thy hand, I pray thee, be against me and against my father's house. And Gad came that day to David and said unto him, go up, rear an altar unto the Lord, where? In the threshing floor of Arunah the Jebusite. You know where that was? Mount Moriah. That was Mount Moriah. The same place where Abraham offered his son. The same place where Abraham was willing to offer his only begotten son is the same place where David had to make an offering and a sacrifice. The place where wheat and chaff were separated. Okay. And yet, verse 19. And David, according to the saying of Gad, went up as the Lord commanded. And Arunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Arunah went out and bowed himself before the king on his face before the ground. And Arunah said, wherefore is the Lord my king come to his servant? And David said, to buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar unto the Lord, that the plague may be stayed from the people. And Arunah said unto David, you don't got to pay me nothing for it. I'll give it to you. You got it. And David said, no. I got to buy it. I got to pay for it. And he says, because I'm not going to allow this to happen without costing me something. But there was another reason why he had to buy it. Because he had to buy the property. David bought the property that the Temple Mount is on right now. It was paid for. He paid for it, and he built an altar there, and that's where the plague stopped. The place where eventually the temple would be built. But the property, when they try to say that the Jews have no claim to the property there on the Temple Mount, David bought it. He paid for it. He owned the land. It was his. Okay. Now, if you read through, through the scriptures, and there's a lot of scriptures we could spend a lot of time reading, a lot of different verses, but basically, when David died, his son Solomon took over the reins. And Solomon, David wanted to build a temple for the Lord. God wouldn't let him because his hands were bloody. So when Solomon came along, David said, Solomon, you're going to build a temple. He gave him the plans. He had all the gold and everything amassed, all the stuff that he would need. It was all there. He said, Solomon, build a temple. And where did Solomon build the temple? Right on Mount Moriah. Right there. That's where he built it. And Solomon's temple was just amazing. Again, I'm just going to read from 2 Chronicles, just a few verses here. 2 Chronicles. It's weird. Okay. 2 Chronicles chapter 3. Lou, get that up for me. Okay, no, I can't. Okay. I couldn't throw him any curveballs in there because he's...
That ain't going to work. He could run upstairs and do it.
In 2 Chronicles chapter 3, in the very first verse, it says this. Solomon began to build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem in Mount Moriah, where the Lord appeared unto David his father, in the place that David had prepared in the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite, or Arunah the Jebusite. It's a place where Abraham offered his son Isaac. Okay, so we see this piece of property is a very important piece of property. It has a very important purpose. Solomon built that temple, and if you read about when they finished the temple, and all the priests came to the temple, and they had a great worship service, and the glory of God came down, and you know what? They all got slain in the spirit, man. They went right down, all right? Even better than Benny Hinn. it was like the power of God came down. And all these priests, when they made all the offerings and sacrifices, it was for real. And when Solomon built that temple, he did so as a worship unto the Lord. I mean, we remember when Solomon first started his reign, God asked him, Solomon, what would you have me do for you? And Solomon said, I need wisdom. I'm young and stupid. I don't know what to do. And God gave him wisdom, and he gave him wealth and riches and everything else. He was a great king. But so he built this temple. It's a beautiful temple. Somebody said if they built it today, it'd be worth billions of dollars, gold and silver, and everything was just laid out, decked out. And that's where the priests would make the sacrifice. That's where the ark, they still had the Ark of the Covenant. They brought it in. When they brought it in, man, the power, the Shekinah glory of God came down, boom. And everybody was really blessed, you know. Well, it wasn't too many years after that maybe a couple hundred, that the Israelites started to fall away. Even Solomon, toward the end of his life, who built this temple, he started marrying strange women. But I meant foreign women.
That's good. That's better. Yeah.
He started marrying foreign women, and he started worshiping their gods. He started, so God became displeased with him. So that started a trail of a stiff-necked idolatry. The Jews. There were a few good kings, but most of the kings were pretty wicked. They worshipped idols and everything, and they defiled the temple. Until eventually God said enough. He allowed the Babylonians to come. You know, Jeremiah the prophet warned them, and the other prophets said, man, you guys got to get right because God's going to send judgment. Well, he did. He sent Nebuchadnezzar in there, and he destroyed the temple, and he took the Jews away captive for 70 years, and the temple Jerusalem laid in ruins. And after those 70 years, I'm just giving you a little synopsis here so we don't have to keep turning pages. After those 70 years, the Jews came back. God raised up a king named Cyrus who allowed the Jews to come back. You know what they did? They rebuilt. They started rebuilding the temple. They started rebuilding the wall, and they started rebuilding the temple. And when they laid the foundation of the new temple, or what was called the second temple, when they laid the foundation, a lot of the younger people, they saw that, they were like, praise the Lord, hallelujah, we're going to get a new temple. But the older guys that remembered the old temple that was like glorious, they wept. So some of them were like leaping and jumping for joy, some of them were crying because they remembered the glory of the first temple. But the prophet Haggai said something in Haggai chapter 2. And these minor prophets. Okay. Back here somewhere. It's like a small town. If you blink, you miss it.
Before Zechariah.
Next to the last. No. Three from the last. Here it is. Okay. In Haggai chapter 2, in verse 3, the temple was finished, or it had been laid, and in chapter 2 and verse 3 it says this. It says, I'll start with verse 1. It says, in the seventh month, in the first and 20th day of the month, came the word of the Lord by the prophet Haggai, saying, speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, who is the governor, and to Joshua, who is the high priest, and to the residue of the people, saying, who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? The old ones, remember the old temple. And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison as nothing? Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, and thus says the Lord, and be strong, O Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and be strong, all ye people in the land, says the Lord, and work. For I am with you, says the Lord of hosts, according to the word that I covenanted with you when you were out of Egypt. He said, listen, the glory of the second one is going to be greater than even the first. Yeah. Now, that didn't make any sense to them because they were looking at this thing and they were saying, wow, you know, it doesn't look like much. He says, for thus says the Lord of hosts, yet once in a little while, and I will shake the heavens, and the earth, and the sea, and the dry land, and I will shake all nations, and the desire of nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. He says, listen, if the glory of the latter house is going to be greater than the former. That's what he promised them. Okay, now fast forward another 400 years. After Malachi, the last prophet in the Old Testament, they didn't hear from God for 400 years. So in the time of Jesus, that temple was still there. But you know what happened to that temple? The temple that was just a small, you know, it was like a much smaller temple than it was at the beginning. You know what happened to it? It was like when Jesus went to the temple, looked at it, it was like a glorious thing again. Maybe even more glorious than Solomon's temple. But what happened? Was this like a great move of God that they had this great temple there? Yeah. No, what happened? What happened was there was a king named Herod who was an Edomite, an enemy of Israel. He was the great king. He built that temple, not for the glory of God. When Solomon built the temple, he built it for the glory of God, but Herod built it for the glory of himself. Yeah. He wanted the people to like him, so he built this great temple. But Jesus still respected when he would go to the temple. When he went there, remember that he went there one time, and he drove out the money changers, right? Yeah. You know, he said, this is a, my house should be called a house of prayer, but you made it den of thieves and so forth. Jesus still respected that temple, even though it was built by a pagan, because of the land.
Yeah.
David owned the land there. So they had this great and glorious temple. And now this is, I read all that just to get to here. It'll take a long time. Okay, over in Matthew, and this is a really popular passage, Matthew chapter 24, okay? No one will be reading this. Jesus, this is just a couple days before his crucifixion, right? The Jews are getting ready to kill him. And his disciples, they thought he was going to be the king of Israel. They were ready. See, you kind of like take it for granted. I like to remind myself all the time. And these disciples, they were ready to rumble. They were ready to fight, man. They were ready to revolt. Okay? So, he had just gave a scathing rebuke of the leaders of Israel in chapter 23, and he says this. Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him to show him the buildings of the temple. So the disciples said, Jesus, look at this great temple. Look at how marvelous it is. Man, it's got all these buildings and gold and silver. And like Jesus was supposed to be impressed. This is what some Edomite, some pagan built. Right? Here's what Jesus said. You see all these things, he says? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And when they heard that, I mean, he's been saying, this place is coming down. When they heard that, in verse 3, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately and said, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of your coming and of the end of the world? Jesus, what? The temple's going to be torn down? Now we know, history tells us, that this is going on about 33 AD or 30 AD, somewhere in there. 70 AD, after Jesus was crucified, 40 years after Jesus was crucified, a Roman general named Titus came into Jerusalem, and the Jews were revolting. So they surrounded the city, and there was a great famine in the city. They said that people were actually taking food out of other people's mouths because they were starving, and the Romans. And Titus did not want to destroy the temple. He wanted to go in and kind of make a deal with the leadership of Israel, say, hey, listen, quit giving us trouble, we'll let you keep the temple. But what happened was they went in and the temple got destroyed.
Right.
Tore down.
Yeah.
Burnt down, destroyed. The rocks came off, everything, right? So what Jesus said came true. But these next few verses really look beyond that. He's kind of dealing with that a little bit, but he's looking much more beyond that. Because right now, here's 2,000 years later, we're talking about building a temple on the Temple Mount. They have the vessels. The Jewish rabbis who really want to build another temple, they have like the priest's garments. They've been making the vessels, the candlestick. They got all this stuff ready to go.
Yeah.
Now, here's what he said. Take heed that no man would deceive you. Nobody wants to deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled. But does this sound like anything like we're living through right now? See, this is why I say this is like ancient news today. What he's talking about 2,000 years ago is going on today. And the reason why we've been talking about this kind of stuff on Wednesday nights is because we need to be equipped that when we read about and hear about stuff going on, we need to understand it's nothing.
Nothing.
We shouldn't say, I'm so surprised. Why are you surprised? God said it's going to happen.
Yeah. Right.
He says, wars, rumors of wars, you shall hear of it, and you shall see that you be not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For a nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. Yeah. And some people say, well, there's always been stuff like that. But now we're getting it all at once. And we're living in a world where we hear about it. You know, in his day, if something was going on in North America, they'd never hear about it.
Yeah.
But today, we get to watch it live, in live time, you know, real time. We get to see disaster. We get to hear about stuff that's going on in North Korea and China and Africa. And we get to hear about all this stuff. And we see all this stuff. And it's happening all at once. And he says, all these are the beginning of sorrows. You know what that term beginning of sorrows talks about? Birth pains. Ladies, you ever have a baby?
Yeah.
I never had a baby.
I got you. I had one. Praise
God. You know what that?
Yeah.
I said, on Mother's Day, I said, ain't no man has strength like that. Carry a baby around. Carry a bowling ball that kicks, right? For the better part of 9 months. I mean, that's birth pain. Okay. I know men who know what that's about. All right. Okay. He says these are the beginning of sorrows. These are the birth pains. What we're seeing happening right now today, it's like a woman's getting ready to give birth and she gets these birth pains, these labor pains. Well, the earth, the world is getting labor pains right now. It's getting ready for Jesus to come back. Because all these things are happening at once. And we're seeing it. We're seeing it on our TVs and here on the internet. All this stuff is going on. The scientists trying to break through. The politicians trying to usurp God's authority. Trying to kick God out of everything. This is going on. So we should be like excited. Because, wow, this is like what we were told about. So listen to what Jesus was saying. It says, then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. He's speaking this primarily to Jews. Now, is there a friend of Israel on the earth today?
No.
And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and they shall hate one another. Road rage, right? This morning I got a chance to drive to the North Hills. Man, they're nasty. If you don't know where you're going, boy, if you don't turn on that red light, they're going to let you know. Okay. Many false prophets. It says, many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many will wax cold. Does this sound at all familiar to anybody? I mean, I got to put surveillance cameras out in front of me. Because of what goes on.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sure when the good Free Methodist folks built this place in 1920, they never thought they would have to do
that.
He says, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. People selling their kids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Leaving a kid out in the parking lot. What? That's not something you hear like once a year. That's every day.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know. We all love our kids. Because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then the end will come. Then he says this, check this out. When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, then let them which be in Judea flee to the mountains. Let them which is on the housetop not come down. That thing about what Daniel was talking about, we're not going to turn there because we're going to close. We're not going to turn there. But if you go to Daniel chapter 9, read that chapter. This is where God gave, the angel Gabriel gave Daniel the vision of what was to come. And he talked about a man of sin. He talked about the 77s, okay? The time from the rebuilding of the wall to the time of the cutting off of the Messiah and the time of the end time tribulation. So a 7-year period. He said that the man of sin, the prince of the people, referring to what we would call the Antichrist, he said he would make a deal with the Jews for 7 years. He'd make a covenant for 7 years. And halfway through that covenant, you know what that guy's going to do? He's going to set himself up. He's going to allow the Jews to build a temple. And then 3.5 years after that, he's going to set himself up in the temple and proclaim that he's God. The same thing Satan tried to do. The same thing they're trying to do. I mean, this is what's going on in the world. This has been Satan's M.O. from the very beginning. And he's gotten us to work with him. Human beings. Now see, a lot of people will try to say, well, all the stuff that Jesus was talking about happened back in 70 A.D., but that never happened. There was never anybody that made a deal with the Jews for 7 years and went and set themselves up as God. That never happened. So either Jesus doesn't know what he's talking about, or there's something coming. There's something coming. You see all this stuff going on about the Temple Mount? You know, United Nations says, well, it doesn't belong to Israel. But David paid for it. That land belongs to Israel. So someday, I don't know when, I don't know if we'll ever see it, they're going to build another temple. What's going to happen? You think the Muslims are going to let them build another temple? I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know if there's going to be a war. I don't know if that the Dome on the Rock can be blown up. I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. But I know the Jews are going to have a third temple.
Yeah,
probably going to be greater than the two other two put together. And they'll pour all kinds of money. I mean, they'll just build that thing. And after they get it built, and after they get, I don't know if they're going to build another ark. I don't know what they're going to do, but after they get that built and they get that mercy seat put in there for 3.5 years, everything's just going to be wonderful. Until the man of sin, Satan's Christ, the Antichrist, that's Satan's Christ, he's going to march in there and he's going to sit on that throne. He's going to say, I've finally done what I set out to do. Taking God's place. And then literally all hell will break loose.
Yeah.
Unlike the earth has never seen. So I want to be prepared. I want you all to be prepared. When you see this stuff happening, you know, we got Democrat, Republican, liberal, conservative, whatever. Listen, forget it. It's either like saved or not saved. I don't care how conservative somebody is and how, you know, whatever they are. They're either saved or they're not saved. They're either a follower of Jesus or they aren't. So we need to be armed and aware. And anyway, praise the Lord. That's the lesson for the night for our Bible study downstairs. I hope it was all right. Anybody have any questions or comments or anything at all? Yes?
When did we do the Temple Mount Moab? I think they say they have everything except for the perfect heifer.
You have to find the red heifer.
The red heifer.
Yep,
the red
heifer.
Which is necessary for the cleansing of the priest. Okay. But they've located a couple. I've heard that they have located a couple.
The Harper, you said, oh yeah, David paid for the lamb. Is that, did that be kind of like what Jesus did for us? David said, I'm going to pay for the area because I sinned. I thought it was kind of neat. I thought, yeah, the plague would stop.
It was a place where judgment stopped, and a place where wheat is fresh, and a place where Abraham was willing to offer his own son, so it's kind of like anybody else have any questions? Yes, Chuck.
When you believe that you're saved, can you lose your salvation or not?
I don't think you can lose it. That's the wrong word. Can a person leave their salvation? There's some scriptures that indicate, I think, that a person can. But it's a conscious, it's a deliberate, you know, you lose your, you know, like I lose my keys. Not like that. But can a person like allow themselves to
like
be caught
backslide or an error and then they're out of
and
church?
If they refuse to allow the Holy Spirit, if they reject the conviction of the Holy Spirit, I believe it's possible for a person to walk away. And then, but once they do, there's like no return. That's not like a backslider. Backslider, God's married to a backslider.
Right.
But a person that absolutely denies Christ after knowing him, I think that's a very drastic, I don't think it's a common thing. Because God will do anything to keep anybody from leaving. But there seems to be scriptures that indicate that that's possible. Now, some people go through the roof if they're not saying that. You know, but the thing is, it's, you know, how you know, God will do anything to keep us from stop believing in him. You know, the Pharisees, they knew who Jesus was. They understood entirely who he was. And they refused to believe him. Jesus talked about the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. That's not making fun of people who talk in tongues. You know, that's not what that is. It's when you just deny what you know is true. And then your heart gets hardened and your conscience gets hardened. And it's like, that's the way I, you know, some people give a different answer. That's the answer I give. Anybody else have any comments or questions?
You think that Schaff book is close to blaspheming the Holy Spirit?
I've never read it, and I it could probably.
What I've read, man, it seems Very close.
Anybody, you know, it's a universalist type thing. And, I mean, I don't know the guy's heart. I mean, only God knows. Maybe God will draw him back. I don't know. You know, but I mean, I wouldn't read it. I don't know. Anybody else have anything at all? Anybody need prayer tonight? Yes.
I have my granddaughter's birthday is on Friday. She'll be 3 years old.
Three?
Yeah, we're going to see her.
Yeah.
So just pray that Michelle gets our life back together and do him really bad again. And I'm a backslider. Yeah. So I want to pray that I come here and get back on track.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for our sister right now because I know she knows you. Brothers and Karen, can you maybe just lay hands on Michelle? Stretch your hands away, Father. She wants to get her life back together.
Yes,
Father, she's gone down a lot of different roads, but Lord, I just pray that by the power of God, that you would do it, but she can't, she could never do herself, or what doctors, or what rehabs, or what they can't do, Father, you can do it. And I'm just praying right now, Lord, in the name of Jesus. You've heard the cry of her heart, and Father, I know that you love her, and we believe that you're able, Father. And we're standing with her right now. We'll always stand with her, Father, and believe for complete deliverance and complete healing and a testimony for all of the power of God in the name of Jesus. Pray for her daughter, Rochelle, for this precious little three-year-old, Father. They don't get to see you. I pray that someday there will be a renewal of a relationship there, Father, in Jesus' name. And you will do the work, Father, and do what needs to be done, Father, in the name of Jesus. We're not giving up. We're not going to stop praying. And I pray, Lord, and I pray that she doesn't stop praying. But we believe that you're able, because you love her. Father, you love her with a love that nobody can ever understand. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. You're able, Father, in the name of Jesus. I pray for Chase. I know Father, we're praying for her son, Chase, in the name of Jesus. God, you see what's going on there, Father. We're putting that in your hands, in the name of Jesus, that you will make a way, Father, to do what's right in your eyes. You do what's right. Father, I pray, God, you would touch our sister and give her faith and calmness. Help her, Father. You see the battle she's been fighting, Father. I pray you give her strength and peace in Jesus' name. Amen. Anybody else need prayer? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm just at the doctor today, and he gave me something for my eyes. So I don't know if it's my blood pressure, but he told me to take these eye drops. So I forgot to tell him I was having pain in my left side. And I turned around, I was taking water, drinking that, because I took a day off of that. And the pain went from my left side the whole way around to my hip to my back. And after I started drinking cranberry juice and that, it's fine. But it seems like it's acting up right now, and I don't know if it's going down to my leg or what. So I didn't get a chance to tell him that. He didn't give me a chance because I was telling him about my eyes, and which is important, but that's what we were talking about.
Mr. Shane, lay your hand. Go ahead, Father, and then maybe Jesus. You're pretty touch our sister, Margaret. And bring healing to her body, Lord. We thank you for the faithfulness and her love of you, Father. I pray, God, that you would touch every muscle, every bone, every blood vessel, Father. Bring healing, complete healing, Father. Every nerve that might not be working the way it should be working, Father. You would touch and heal in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And fill her with your Holy Spirit, Father.
Yes, Father.
In the name of Jesus, we thank you. We pray, Father. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Anybody else want to just follow the prayer? Let's pray for one another. Yes.
Just keep our grandson in prayer because he has to go for that CT scan on 31st. And he did start. He's supposed to, he did his training this week, so he'll be going down to St. Mark's for it.
You bet, Joel. If you can't see St. Mark's, so praise the Lord. Now he has to get drugs.
Yeah.
And a car.
Yeah, a car and a shorts.
Anybody else have anything you want to bring up? Yes, sir.
No, that's a scam.
Yeah.
No, don't give up on your social security.
So you ought to be ashamed of yourself. You're going to go to hell if you don't repent. That's what you're going to tell
I've had three calls saying that I am fraudulent on my taxes. And this is the last time they're going to call. And because they're going to press charges and they're going to arrest me and yada, yada, yada.
So let's get you.
Don't let anybody, if they wouldn't give you money, and they wouldn't, and you they give them money to get it. Remember, Pastor Held, your prayers. Mm-hmm. And all of us. All right, well, if all hearts and minds are true, thanks for being here tonight. I guess the guys are done for tonight. I know they got one too. But thank God for that. Be praying for those guys. And, okay, well, let's stand and close. I'm going to ask Miss Jane, could you close us in prayer?
Oh, Lord, we thank you that we have people who come to your house tonight, Lord, even though we're down here in the basement, Lord, that we heard the good word of Pastor Davis here, and he tells us, you know, to be ready, to be prepared, because we know, Lord, that you're coming back, and may we continue to be the people that you called us to be, Lord, to be about your business while we're here. We're supposed to do that, and to try to bring those people that are lost out there in a dying world, Lord, to try to bring them into your kingdom here, Lord, before it's too late. But sometimes that's very hard, Lord. People, they don't want to hear, they don't want to see. They're not interested. They want to go about their business there. But like you told them, you have a decision starting today of where you want to spend eternity, and you better make up your mind soon, because there's going to come a day here you wish that you had. And so, Lord, until we come back again here Sunday here, Lord, given traveling mercies as we make our way home tonight, Lord. And,